pleased to be here. I just want to congratulate Wendy on choosing such an important subject as you are talking about today. Wendy's very well trained within the Department for Education, so that's where she gets it from. But this is a really important subject. Early intervention, early help, as we referred to it in the Monterey Review, families with multiple problems or troubled families project, as it's now called, attachment science and so on, are all becoming part of the mainstream and also in the language of politics and what goes on in the House of Commons and political scenarios around the country as well. And I think it's importantly taking on a cross-cutting interest across the whole of government. Department for Work and Pensions, Health, DfE, DCLG have all got a share in this agenda. There's one criticism I have, and it's one of the recommendations which I'll come on to, is that it needs to be a rather better joined up project under a single minister, if not a department, across government. But we'll see what happens. Anyway, it was talked about by the Prime Minister in his speech beginning this week in Runcorn. We now have the Early Intervention Foundation, which we set up when I was at the DfE as Children's Minister. We were very pioneering, I think, at the time with the Early Intervention Grant, trying to bring together pots of money across the piece, although it's rather gone by the wayside since it was transferred away from the DfE. And I believe the Troubled Families Programme, which you heard much earlier, is a huge potential game changer for our families and for society as a whole. It's something that seems probably heard. It's now involving all 152 councils in this country, and again, importantly, across all party lines. It's helped, as at the end of last month, 117,000 families across the country. A further 400,000 are planned to be included by 2020. It was designed, it was launched within the Department for Education and later, it's my better judgment, but there we go, transferred to the DCLG under Louise Casey and Eric Pickles. I remember when I was a minister, I actually adopted a troubled family in West London, and me and my private office spent some time with that family, particularly cooking them steak, I seem to recall, and we offered to go cooking dinner, and they had some very elaborate tastes in what they like to eat. But it was really interesting, actually, to get out and deal with some of those troubled families at first hand, as I've done in my own constituency. And in fact, my constituency, East Worthing and Shoreham down in Sussex, were early adopters of the Troubled Families Programme. We call it Think Family down there. And it's been hugely successful across the county of West Sussex. We've now turned around 1,165 families, ahead of target and ahead of time. 665 adults went to work for the first time. 158 families saw a reduction in involvement in crime, and 660 children went back to school full time. These are real people, real families, in real communities whose lives are being transformed. And we've been tasked with turning around a further 4,060 families by 2020. So it's a big challenge. And there's clear empirical evidence about reducing antisocial behaviour and a reduction in calls for intervention by local council officers and officials. Now, I know this needs to be treated with all sorts of caveats, and it is early days for a proper evaluation of the sustainability of these families getting back on an even keel and staying buoyant. But I think the direction of travel is right, and I think the early results are encouraging, and the response from people involved in it has been really good. And as a subtext, I think also it's produced a dividend of good models for better joined up partnership working between agencies and an analysis of pooling budgets and investing to save. And one of the big myths in government was this phrase about joined up government. And yet joined up government in practice just doesn't happen. And I remember when we were devising the early intervention grant, I was getting, and this wasn't Wendy, I was getting all sorts of comments from officials about, well, that's all very interesting, Minister, but I don't think we could quite do that. So what happened in the end is myself, Sarah Tether, who was another Minister of the Department for Education, got on our mobile phones to other colleagues who were ministers at the Department for Health, Department for DCLG, and others, and we had supper one night at the pizza restaurant in the House of Commons, and we decided amongst ourselves what we wanted to do, and we all went back to our departments the following day and said, this is how we're going to run the early intervention grant, this is how we'd like you to do it. To which there are lots of harumphs and say, well, that's not the way we do it, Minister. Well, tough, we've done it, we've organised it, we've agreed to get on with it. And it was as frustrating as that, and still there is too much mechanism and furniture of government and the civil service that gets in the way of doing something that is common sense is sensible. And the Troubled Families Programme, I think, has been really helpful in breaking down a lot of those barriers and the sort of, well, this is the way we will do things around here approach. So there's been some really interesting and valuable innovation that has come out of it. Now, there's no doubt why the Chancellor has committed to expand funding for the scheme in the future, because it can clearly be shown that there's a financial payback from investment over and above the very clear social one. Some of the studies from around the country, Manchester has estimated that every pound it's spent on the Troubled Families Programme, it's saving at least £2.20. Wandsworth, in its first year of operation, estimated it was saving £1.2 million in the criminal justice system alone. Salford saved their health service £1,700 a family. They estimated, and overall, so far, the programme has saved something like £1.2 billion. Now, we need to address this in terms of investing to save. We invest large amounts of money in our road system in order to make transport easier, in order to make people able to get to their places of work and be productive and contribute to the economy. Why should it be no less important that we invest in some of these schemes, and even earlier intervention, as I'll come on to make people able to go about their lives more easily, become contributing members of society, add to the economy and pay something back to the wealth of the country as a whole. And following on from the success of the Troubled Families programme, the Children's Charity for Children has advocated a complementary Troubled Teenagers programme to provide a young people-focused, intensive and joined-up help needed to enable vulnerable teenagers with significant difficulties turning around their lives. But of course, importantly, the Troubled Families programme is an holistic project, usually engaging with all members of the family, where mental health is one of the most common elements. And other elements, such as 1 in 15 of young people are deliberately self-harming, a particularly worrying statistic. 40% of jobless young people face mental health symptoms. 44,000 young people in this country have been sentenced for a crime. So teenagers, young people, are particular focuses of what the Troubled Families Programme is doing and needs to do. Now, in his speech on Monday, the Prime Minister hailed the success of the Troubled Families Programme and spoke about tackling the underlying causes of those families and their problems, not just reacting to the subsequent symptoms. But surely we are missing a trick here, because the causes of addiction, truancy, and social behaviour attachment dysfunction happen well before what the Troubled Families Programme comes on the local authority radar, or the families themselves. Indeed, it usually comes before a troubled family becomes troubled together. The elements of that family have sown the seeds of later problems. Now, one of my interesting experiences as Minister, I used to spend a week, a year in the recess, going out on the road working with professionals. And the first year I spent a week being a social worker in Stockport, going out with social workers, without cameras and things, dealing with real life cases. And of course, the social workers stored up the very worst cases to show me. I remember the first house we went to, it was a particularly rundown part of Stockport. We went to a pretty rundown local authority owned house. There was a young mum who had four sons under the age of 12 by three different fathers, none of whom were around. There was no furniture in the house other than what was dumped at the bottom of the garden. There was no food in the house. The kids were literally eating something that had been thrown together from the floor. There were four soiled mattresses in a bedroom and a pile of clothes where these kids slept. And I went to see the family with this really good social worker. And one of the kids had a serious toothache problem and had had it for some weeks, was visibly in pain as we were talking. And the social worker said, look, why haven't you got this sorted out? I've been banging on to you about it for ages. And the day we went, that young mum had had a tooth problem herself, had rung up the emergency dentist, had gone to the emergency dentist, but didn't have the presence of mind to take little Johnny with her to have his tooth problem fixed as well. And I came out of that house thinking, actually, should we not be taking those children into care? And wouldn't that be a better prospect for them? Because clearly that mother was incapable, on the face of it, of looking after those children. But when you thought about it, if those children had gone into care, probably they would have been split up. Probably some of them would have been moved out of there and had to move down the school. And for all her inadequacies, those four kids absolutely doted on their mum, and for all her inadequacies as a parent, that mum absolutely doted on the kids, and they would have fallen to pieces if they'd been separated. No end of professionals had been in and out of that door. The health visitor, the child welfare officer from the school, all sorts of others. But none of it had been joined up. And what she needed was somebody to take control of her, almost literally get her by the scruff of the neck, march her down to the children's centre to get some decent parenting classes, march her down to the dentist to sort out her son's problems as well, and march her down to Asda to teach her about buying a weekly shop and cooking for your kids. That is what the Troubled Families programme is all about, but somebody who can take control of somebody's life and try and get them back on track. But why had she got to that state? And the reason she got to that state, she had been really badly parented herself in a house where there was domestic violence, where she had seen and grown up with abuse of her mother, and accepted that as a norm. And therefore accepted as a norm the abuse that she had from three fathers who were no longer on the scene. The seeds of those problems were sown well before she had her own children, effectively. And so what we need to do is actually, I think, to have a pre-troubled families program. And that's why we need to get at the real root causes of troubled families and go right back to the beginning. And that's just what I want to talk about briefly now. And in particular, I want to focus on the 1001 Days critical days manifesto, which colleagues and I produced a couple of years ago, and the all-party group for 1001 Critical Days, which is pushing forward this agenda, and the Building Great Britain's report, which we produced just back in February, which is a really fantastic report, which has had quite a lot of coverage. After some 6 months of lots of different experts coming to give evidence sessions in the House of Commons. This is potentially game-changing. Now, our study took up, as part of its theme, the report by the Perinatal Mental Health Alliance, where they produced a study last year which claimed that the cost of not doing what we need to do about the perinatal mental illness was about £8.1 billion a year in each and every one-year cohort of births in the United Kingdom. £8.1 billion. It's equivalent to something like £10,000 per birth is what it's costing for the price of failure. Nearly three quarters of this cost relates to the adverse impacts on the child rather than the mother. A fifth of the total costs are borne by the public sector, with the bulk falling on the NHS and social services. And the average cost to society of just one case of perinatal depression is around £74,000. Of which a third of that relates to the mother and just over £50,000 relates to the impacts on the child. So what are we doing about this? Well, about half of all the cases of perinatal depression and anxiety go undetected and many of those which are detected fail to receive evidence-based forms of treatment, which is not surprising when you learn that just 3% of CCGs in England at the moment have a strategy for commissioning perinatal mental health services. It's a real postcode lottery. And though I very much welcome the news earlier this year that NHS England is making perinatal mental health a priority, we have a long way to go. So in our Building Great Britain's report, we put the total cost of failure of £23 billion a year, representing £8.1 billion of perinatal mental illness costs, and a further £15 billion estimated for child maltreatment in the United Kingdom, based on studies from the Monash University in Australia and the Centre for Disease Control in Atlanta. The two things are closely linked, and more importantly, largely avoidable. Two-thirds of the annual defence budget is represented in that figure. Two-thirds going on a problem that is widespread and, when unchecked, passes from one poorly parented generation to the next. And as we've said in our report, tackling this problem should be no less a priority than defence of the realm. When one considers the estimate of the interlinked cost of family breakdown by the Centre for Social Justice of £48 billion a year, we are dealing with very big numbers and very big social challenges, which at the moment are still passing from generation to generation. Poorly parented children are passing on poor parenting skills to their own children, and at its heart is poor attachment or attachment disorder. Now, poor attachment between parent and baby leads to poor social and physical development and behavioural problems. Often, this can lead to child maltreatment, and then the whole destructive cycle can be played out again by the next generation of parents who have known no better themselves. And it's been calculated that as many as 80% of maltreated children in this country could be classified as having disorganised attachment. So the problem starts in the womb, and the sooner we intervene to remedy poor parenting potential and to encourage strong attachment, the more likely we are to have our children develop into well-balanced, well-grounded members of society, which is what we all want. It's not rocket science. Technically, it's neuroscience, but it's something we need to be doing. Now, those crucial early months of stress-free nurturing in the womb, followed by building a strong attachment between the primary carers, preferably, but not exclusively, both parents, and the baby in his or her first 18 to 24 months, is absolutely crucial and life-changing. Now, from birth to age 18 months, I'm speaking to experts here, I'm sure, connections in the brain are created at a rate of 1 million a second. The earliest experiences shape a baby's brain development and have a lifelong impact on that baby's mental and emotional health. A baby exposed to toxic stress can have their responses to stress, cortisol, distorted in later life. And this early stress can come from a mother suffering from symptoms of depression or anxiety, having a bad relationship with her partner, or an external trauma such as bereavement. And international studies show that when a baby's development falls behind the norm during the first year of life, it is then much more likely to fall even further behind in subsequent years than to catch up with those who have had a better start. So attachment is that crucial bond between a baby and his or her caregiver or caregivers. There is long-standing evidence that a baby's social and emotional development is strongly affected by the quality of their attachment. So the best chance to turn this around is during those 1,001 critical days between conception and age two. At least one loving, sensitive and responsive relationship with an adult caregiver teaches the baby to believe that their world is a good place and reduces the risk of them facing disruptive issues in later life. And I think the science behind this now is widely accepted. There's also evidence about the additional benefits of having that love and attention, obviously, of both parents. And there's also evidence about having that love and attention present at night, where children's fear systems are activated overnight and they need the comfort of familiar parents' needs nearby. It's interesting, when we held a seminar on this a few months ago, that somebody in charge of the CAM service from a local authority in the West Country said that some 70% of referrals to his care service named parental separation as a significant factor. And given the number of families that break up, this is an additional stress on those kids, particularly if that breakup happens in their very early years. So the implications of all this can be lifelong and often are only first manifested formally when those young children reach school. An interesting study in Tottenham recently about reading age skills. Nearly half of the 4 and 5 year olds at one school in Tottenham, beginning their reception classes, had a repertoire of just 30 to 50 words. Yet by that age, standard children should have a repertoire of some 1,500 to 2,000 words. Implicit in that was a lack of communication within those households, that lack of attachment, bonding with their caregivers. I've referred to primary carers, but of course in some cases, it will just not be possible for children to grow up with their own parents, which is why stability for children in the care system is so crucial, and why finding a stable, loving family to step in for those children whose childhood would never safely be with their own parents is particularly important, and particularly important for those children heading for adoption. And that's why I think the government's adoption reforms to speed up the whole process are so important. 2 months is 1% of a child's childhood. Those months are never going to be reclaimed. Those initial 24 months are particularly precious, which is why everything must be done to enable strong attachments to form as early and as consistently and strongly as possible. Now, women experiencing perinatal mental illness are in a weaker position to form those vital bonds and promote that attachment. And the numbers involved, as I've said, are significant. 122,000 babies are affected by parents' mental health problems every year. 109,000 babies in this country are affected by a parent with drug and or alcohol problems, and that's often interlinked with mental health problems as well. And over a quarter of babies in the United Kingdom have a parent who have been affected by domestic violence. One thing I really appreciated going out with social workers, seeing cases at first hand, is how many cases of child abuse have domestic violence as a common element directly linked to them. And of course, we know that over a third of domestic violence incidents start during a woman's pregnancy as well. And we know that there's a direct link between children who come from homes where there is domestic violence growing up into parents who habitually inflict domestic violence on a partner, or in the case of women, accepted almost as the norm from a partner. My mom got hit, so why should I expect anything different, or at the very least to be abused in some form or the other? So the incidence of disorganised attachment between parents and infants is greater in highly conflicted parental relationships, and particularly pronounced when parents are living apart. An unresolved and poorly managed conflict between parents can create long-term emotional and behavioural problems in children. But we've included the cost of maltreatment in our study as one of this country's greatest, but I think little publicised, social challenges. Studies by Harvard University found that specific changes in key regions in and around the hippocampus in the brains of young adults who were neglected or maltreated in childhood. And these changes leave victims more vulnerable to depression, addiction, and post-traumatic stress disorders later in life. And currently, there are 1 million children suffering some sort of conduct, behavioural, or emotional disorder. 20% of adults in the United Kingdom have suffered from some form of maltreatment, and the most important predictor of depression during pregnancy is, of course, the mother's own maltreatment by her own parents as a child. No section of society is immune either. Deprivation may lead to a greater concentration of affected families, but middle-class mothers can be just as prone to perinatal mental health problems and the impact on their children. These are big figures. This is a big problem. And the cause of the problem so often leads back to poor attachment and the fact that 15% of children have disorganized attachment behavior, leading to high levels of entry into care, high levels of disruptive behavior in schools and preschool exclusion, poor physical and mental health, and aggressive and often antisocial behavior, ending in entry into the criminal justice system in too many cases. So why is more not being done about it? Surely this level of problem should raise as some form of national emergency, and one that we need to turn around to break a cycle of generational blight. And there are solutions, effective solutions. It's been calculated that if we can effectively prevent such adverse childhood experiences as abuse, neglect, and witnessing domestic violence, we could reduce addiction to heroin or crack by 59%. We could reduce violence amongst young people by 51%. We could reduce incarceration by 53%, and we could reduce unplanned teen pregnancies by 38%, with all the accompanying financial and social savings and benefits that brings. Say again, it's not rocket science, it's neuroscience. So the 1001 Days Critical Manifesto was launched to try and get a new approach to early intervention and for recognition of the importance of healthy attachments to be included in mainstream political manifestos and in what our health service does day in, day out. The all-party group on the 1001 Days continues to bring pressure to bear on all the political parties who are represented in it, and the series of evidence sessions that led up to our report have been published in full on our website for the Building Great Britain's report. And in practice, I also chair a charity called the PIT UK, Parent and Infant Partnership Charities, where we have been funding centres around the country, usually working under children's centres, to identify and work with, usually mothers, with attachment disorder problems. With remarkable success, we have branches at Oxford, in Oxford, in Liverpool, in Enfield, in South Northamptonshire, and we have further ones on stream coming in, Croydon and Brighton and several others before the end of this year. It's a really exciting project, producing some really heavyweight data about the benefits that we can bring early on in that relationship between usually the mum and a young baby. I'll just end on the recommendations that we made in our report. 9 main recommendations, but you can download the report from the pipuk.org.uk website or 1001 Critical Days, just Google that. We made 9 recommendations. Firstly was about political commitment, urging all of the political parties to make an undertaking to adopt the 1001 Days approach. Secondly, a local commitment requiring all local authorities, CCGs and health and wellbeing boards to adopt and implement a 1001 Days strategy and to produce it with partner agencies within the next 5 years. We urged a national government commitment to establish a 1001 Days strategy fund to support local authorities and CCGs to make a decisive switch over the next 5 years to a primary preventative approach in those first 1001 days. Importantly, to monitor it, and this using my experience of the adoption reforms, that we wanted to establish scorecards, similar to the adoption scorecards, to monitor exactly how those local agencies were taking this problem seriously and what they were doing about it in action, so we could see clear evidence of where there were leaders and laggards in local authorities or health authorities around the country. Fifthly, that to build on the early help recommendation of the Munro Review, we require and support all relevant agencies in prevention to work together to prevent child maltreatment and promote secure attachment. Sixthly, and this is a process thing, but it's an important point that I made at the outset, that we should appoint a Minister for Families and Best Start in Life with a cross-cutting remit across all the departments of government to have an interest in this. Seventhly, something close to my heart, we should have joint inter-agency training on the importance of the early years for social and emotional development. And as I've seen so many times around child protection issues, when you have in the same room a GP, a social worker, a teacher, police officer, whoever, being taught from the same manual, understanding the same language, knowing when to interact with each other and the thresholds that trigger action, you're much more likely to get effective and and timely intervention. And we don't do enough on joint agency training, and we don't do enough on joint agency inspection, although this is starting to happen later this year, although I was trying to initiate it back in 2011. And finally, two things: that children's centres should become a central source of support for families in the early years, with access to multi-agency teams and multiple on-site services, including health visiting, GP services, housing finance, parenting classes, birth registration, library and other community services, the hub approach that certain organisations have been pushing for. And finally, to make sure that research evidence and good local area data are collected to ensure effective changes are implemented to services based on good evidence. Now, that's a big ask, but I think that the wind is blowing in our direction. It is a huge false economy to not be taking this agenda on board now, and every day we delay, it's likely that another generation will pass on those poor attachment, poor parenting skills, and the results of all that we know, to our cost, but more importantly, to the social cost of too many of our young people in this country today. So, I say again, I really welcome the initiative that Wendy's taken at this conference today. I really welcome those of you who are dedicated to this whole agenda of early intervention and a joined up approach. We've come a long way, we've a long way to go, but there's an awful lot of the futures, an awful lot of our young people that rely on getting this right in the future. Thank you very much.